From Buck Island Studios in lovely West Yarmouth, Massachusetts, it's the Liberty Freelance with Dr. Lindeman podcast. Welcome back. On today's episode, I'm going to tell you about a documentary streaming now on Netflix called Bad Sport. I'm going to tell you about a loss for liberty and the lovers of thereof from the great state of California. And I'm going to tell you both those things, but first, I need to tell you this. So a rabbi, a priest, and a minister walk into a bar, and the bartender leans over and tells his buddy, "There's something funny going on." Okay, the best way to ruin a joke is to explain it, so we're going to go on and talk about Bad Sport. Bad Sport is a six-part documentary, docu-series, I think is what the genre is referred to now, which is, in this case, a melding of sports stories and true crime stories, because all of them involve crimes and all of them involve sports. Now, of the set of six, really five of them belong there, and one of them is the exception, and see if you can guess which it is. The first episode is about the 1994 Arizona State basketball team that was involved in a point-shaving scandal. In other words, some of the players were taking money from gamblers to win ball games by a certain amount so that gamblers would win their bets. The second episode was about a race car driver who drove Indy cars and various other types of vehicles named Randy Lanier, who in the 90s funded his racing team with the proceeds of his extremely lucrative marijuana import business. The third episode is about the scandal that erupted in Italian soccer several years ago when it turned out that the director, who's sort of like the owner of a team in Turin called Juventus, turned out he was influencing referees that may have affected the outcomes of games. Episode four is about the 2002 Winter Olympics scandal, where there was a wonderful Canadian couple who just blew the roof off in their figure skating competition, but were not granted the gold medal, at least right away, because one of the judges was involved in a scandal, in a scam to fix the outcome. Episode five was, in many ways, was one of the most disturbing ones. It's about a guy who was a horse hitman. He was hired by extremely wealthy show horse owners to murder horses so that the owners could recoup the insurance benefits. Like I said, hard to watch. And then finally, the scandal revolving around the South African cricket team. This episode stood out in that it's one sport about which I understand a zippo, nada. I mean, I understand baseball, but cricket kind of looks like baseball, but it ain't. In any case, the cricket captain of South Africa at one time was a man named Hansie Cronje, and it turned out that he was taking money from gamblers to influence outcomes of games as well. All right, the episode that doesn't fit in my view, is the episode about Randy Lanier, the race car driver. Nothing that he did influenced what he did on the track. This was only the way that he got his money to race, and what this has to do with cheating or in any way diminishing the sport of racing is beyond me. Nobody involved in the scandal, everybody involved in the scandal did time in jail, but not that much time. I mean, it was weed. There was one unfortunate event in which two members of his team were killed in an explosion trying to liberate their trapped marijuana from the hull of a ship, and that kind of sucked. But for the rest of these, here's the take-home message. The take-home message is that sport, particularly at its highest levels, is ripe for corruption. And the fact that many people attach so much emotional valence to sport, in my view, is a mistake. It's entertainment. It should be viewed as entertainment. such that you're able to accept into that space the fact that what you may be watching may be a put-on, a fake, a fix, and just enjoy it. But don't delude yourself that what you're watching is absolutely 100% pure athletic competition. Now, on to the latest hit for liberty. This is from Courthouse News Service, Dateline, 12 October 2021. Ninth Circuit shuts down journalists' challenge to California's freelance law. And this is written by Dustin Manduffy. And Dustin's article goes like this. A three-judge Ninth Circuit panel found Wednesday that a federal court was correct in dismissing a lawsuit filed by the American Society of Journalists and Authors and the National Press Photographers Association challenging the state's passage of Assembly Bill 5 and its various amendments. AB 5 took effect on January 1, 2020, limiting the type of work certain freelancers in the state can perform without being considered on-staff employees. Many journalists and photographers cried foul when the bill was passed, claiming it would severely limit job opportunities for California-based freelancers and have negative impact on their livelihoods. Almost immediately after its passage, numerous companies began adding disclaimers to their freelance job postings for writers and photographers, stating that residents of California would not be considered because of the new restrictions. The bill codified the ABC test, first presented in a California Supreme Court case against Dynamex, and now used to determine whether a worker should be classified as an employee or an independent contractor. To classify someone as a contractor rather than an employee, a company must show that they do not directly control the worker, that the tasks performed by the worker fall outside the company's primary business, and that the worker is, quote, customarily engaged in an independently established trade. If a business cannot tick all three boxes, they must deem a worker to be an employee. In other words, if they cannot show that they do not directly control the worker, in other words, they directly control the worker, if they cannot show that the tasks performed by the worker fall outside the company's primary business, in other words, they do fall within the company's primary business, and if the worker if they can't show that the worker is customarily engaged in an independently established trade, that person's an employee and not a contractor. So, I'm going to skip down a little bit. Essentially, what journalists were saying was that they were being treated differently from other freelancers who were protected by subsequent amendments to AB 5. And the California Supreme Court said, nah, they're not really doing that. Now, here's the problem. This is where we get really deep into the constitutional law weeds. The question comes down to whether this restriction on their ability to express themselves, they being freelancers, constitutes a violation of the First Amendment. And the particular nuance here is the function or purpose of that speech. And some functions and purposes are protected by the First Amendment and some are not. And the world is still trying to work out the difference. Suffice to say, it's not good for California. It's not good for freelancers. And as I've said many times before and will say again, the best thing that California could have done for freelance workers of any stripe would have been to stay the hell out and just not try to fix anything. So, final word that I've got for you is a plea, a request. If you've been deriving any enjoyment, knowledge, thrills from the Liberty Freelance with Dr. Lindeman podcast, I'd like you to do me a favor, if you're listening to us on the YouTube channel, to subscribe, share the show, ring the bell so that you get notifications. If you're listening to us on one of the podcasting platforms, please consider giving us a 5-star review. And if you don't think we deserve 5 stars, then maybe just move on. But if you do any of those nice things for us, I can be fairly certain that we'll be here next week with some more stuff. Until then, be good to yourselves and each other.